Australia this week won a seat on the UN Security Council, along with powerhouses like Rwanda and Luxembourg. Julia Gillard was cheered by excited foreign affairs bureaucrats and was so thrilled she even praised Kevin Rudd.
I'd like to thank the former Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd, for having the foresight to launch Australia on this campaign.
Joining me are Nick Minchin, former Liberal Finance Minister, and Cassandra Wilkinson, former Labor advisor. Cassandra, tell us what a great thing this was for Australia and for Julia Gillard.
Well, Australia increasing its influence in the world is a good thing. I don't really care particularly whether it's good for Julia or good for anyone else. I don't see this as party political, but the simple calculus for me is that security is good for trade, trade is good for prosperity, trade is certainly good for Australia, and a calm, secure world where the influence of countries like Australia is greater than the influence of countries that are war-torn or unfree, that's a good thing. It's got nothing to do with domestic politics. It's good for the planet.
Nothing to do with domestic politics.
Well, Andrew, the Howard government very wisely decided not to waste taxpayers' money pursuing this temporary seat on a UN committee. But of course, when Kevin Rudd became Prime Minister, he committed Australia to wasting lots of money pursuing this seat. And what it's really involved is a whole lot of bureaucrats and Labor politicians flying around the world at taxpayers' expense, all in business class, with buckets full of aid money, buying votes from third world countries in order to get this temporary seat on a UN committee where we will have no influence, because all the decisions are made by the permanent members of the UN Security Council. I think it's frankly disgusting that we've spent this money, this time and this effort to pursue something that I think compromises our aid program and potentially compromises our foreign affairs positions, as we've seen with China demanding that we use this position to distance ourselves from our greatest ally, the United States. So I think this is actually a bad outcome, and I'm sorry that the Rudd government ever committed us to this. And now we've got, you know, Bob Carr prancing around the world saying he's going to solve the Syrian civil war. Well, what about, you know, our backyard? We've got lots of problems in the Pacific that he should be focusing on, not thinking he can solve the Syrian civil war, for God's sake.
Cassandra, there is one thing, though. China has signalled that, well, you're now going to distance yourself from America, aren't you? Doesn't this risk putting us in a conflict position with China?
I'm not sure that's as bad as some people say. I mean, the Asian region is full of many more countries than just China, and most of them are more free than China, and many of them are hoping that there will be voices, not strongly opposed, but voices in arguing for different ways of governing than China. And
you know, I just wonder whether this government is strong enough to do that. That's the thing.
Well, the two are two different things. The Australian government may not be strong enough to stand up to China, but it's certainly, our being on the Security Council should be a chance for us to speak for all the Asian nations who do not have communist dictatorships running them.
Well, you say that Julia Gillard had a foreign affairs success. I think Tony Abbott had an even bigger one with his visit to Indonesia. The Indonesian president seemed to go out of his way to make sure that he was embracing Tony Abbott, praising him, giving him the VIP treatment in a way that he has never done for Julia Gillard.
Well, it's possible they see the news polls in Indonesia as well, so maybe he's making friends with the new neighbour.
I think it's more personal than that.
Yeah, I thought it was terrific that Tony had such a good reception from the Indonesian president.
It was the same point, didn't
it? You know what really upset me, though? Ms Gillard, when she's in India, reverts to domestic politics to accuse Tony Abbott of cowardice for not raising a particular subject with the Indonesian president. Now, this is Labor's problem. They make these incredible and non-believable accusations of a personal kind. Now, I thought the Labor line on Tony Abbott was that he was crazy brave. Now it's that he's a coward. No one believes Tony
Abbott's
a coward.
I think a factor of that that's been overlooked, Nick, is that Julia Gillard was saying he didn't raise boat people with the president. Well, in fact, he did.
Exactly.
He did.
Exactly.
And I just wonder what the Indonesian president would make of Julia Gillard to know her that she's spinning something that's not true about his meeting with Tony Abbott. What would he think?
Look, I don't think the Indonesian government, with its much larger population and problems, wastes a lot of its time wondering what domestic politicians make of it. The thing that disappointed me about that was that we spent a lot of time talking about whether or not the Indonesians were happy with our policy on boat people, and a lot less time than we should have talking about whether we ourselves are happy with our policy. I don't really care what the Indonesians think of it. I mean, the fact is they've turned a blind eye traditionally. They have not been very cooperative, and there's...
But that's the point, that's Cassandra. Exactly. They have not been cooperative because the relationship between Julia Gillard and President Yudhoyono is dysfunctional. They are not helping. And Tony Abbott needs Indonesia's help. I don't think it's irrelevant. Because have a look, Nick. Since the Nauru option was reopened by Labor, we've had they've sent over 300 people to Nauru. Yeah, in return, we've got 5,000 people actually landing here. 16-1 imbalance. Yeah. It's not working. Nauru's failed.
Well, this is the trouble. You know, our policies when we were in government had destroyed this evil trade in people smuggling, and regrettably, Labor, self-righteously and in a moralising fashion, allowed this people smuggling trade to be rebuilt. And it's going to be a lot tougher and harder now to break this evil trade.
For both sides.
And, yeah, exactly. It's going to be very tough for an Abbott government, if it gets there, to do this, having rebuilt this sophisticated trade in people smuggling. And you're going to have to rule with your head on this, not your heart, to stop this trade and put in a lot of disincentives for people getting on these boats. I think the Australian government has to contemplate a situation where anybody who pays a people smuggler to get to Australia must be told they will never, ever get permanent residency here, and nor will any of their relatives. That this is the sort of policy you've got to introduce if you're going to stop this trade.
This trade exists because, unlike every other form of deregulation, which we embraced, and under your government as well, boldly and sensibly embraced financial deregulation, we embraced foreign capital, we embraced the flow of Australian workers to other countries, the one freedom that we did not embrace was freedom of movement, and we have not done ourselves the favour of allowing a large migrant workforce who wants to come and live here to come here.
We have one of the highest migration rates in the world, 200,000 a year.
And we're not saying embrace the freedom.
That's
not
saying embrace the in a very large country. You look at what made America great.
You want more than 200,000
a
year?
Yes, I do. Yes, I do.
Well,
I don't see why we can't.
That's another argument, but they shouldn't self-select by paying people smugglers to come here.
They don't self-select to be born in a country riven with civil war. They don't self-select.
Look, it's a noble program. But I don't think, even if you wanted unregulated immigration into Australia, I don't think the public would buy it. And I think that's the disaster.
There's a long and rich journey between completely unregulated and having an orderly arrival of a far greater number of people. People smuggling exists because there's a problem out there that too many people live in countries where it is intolerable to live. And we have the opportunity to welcome more of them.
We are welcoming as many as we want and think are in the national interest. I think you're saying that they should, that the people smugglers should set the limit, and I don't think people will vote. But can I just move on before we run out of time?
Scapegoat for our policy failings.
Well, can I run out before we run out of time? MAIFA, the government's mid-year economic forecast, will come out next week with a little mini budget to fix what looks, according to who you believe, a $4 billion hole or a $13 billion crater in government revenue, the difference between revenue and spending. How bad is this for Labor?
I imagine it'll be quite bad. I mean, and the difficulty is that the massive unnecessary middle-class welfare that Labor inherited from the Howard government and didn't have the guts to end...
That's you.
..is crippling the budget.
Evil us.
No, what I'm saying is it's equally bad on both sides. The addiction to middle-class welfare by politicians from both sides is what's killing off the programs that are actually necessary, like trying to do something about disability services.
Yeah, but that's the thing. The disability reforms are going to cost $10 billion a year. The government doesn't have it. It is now up to $13 billion a year in the hole now.
Well, you know, this is the problem. The government set itself this arbitrary target of delivering this wafer-thin surplus in the current financial year and manipulated the budget in order to achieve it by moving money around. Now it looks as though they won't even be able to achieve that wafer-thin surplus. So we're going to have not a mid-year economic and fiscal outlook, but a less than one-third year economic fiscal outlook.
Why?
Because they've panicked. They've got information that shows they're not going to get this surplus. They're going to have to get tax increases and revenue cuts in as soon as they possibly can, less than 4 months after they announced the start of this financial year, in order to be able to scrape over the line with a surplus for this financial year. I mean, the revenue forecasts were always optimistic. The problem with the mining tax is that they've made the budget hostage to the fluctuations in very volatile commodity prices, and that's very bad for the budget, having committed a whole lot of expenditure based on those rosy assumptions. reasons. The fiscal disaster this government is responsible for is outrageous. I mean, $150 billion worth of debt that they've accumulated in just 5 years is appalling.
OK, now, look, we've got to go, but I want to cheer you up as a fellow sceptic, Nick, with a little graphic. No warming for 16 years now. Cassandra, will this finally make Labor think, hey, gosh, maybe global global warming isn't as bad?
16 years is a mere pause of breath in the history of the planet. 16 years is not really a trend.
OK. And, Nick?
Well, why aren't the warmers out there celebrating the fact that we have no warming? It hasn't warmed for 16 years. Let's celebrate.
Oh, we're safe. Oh, gee. Look, Cassandra Wilkinson, Nick Minchin, thank you so much for joining me.